What up? I'm Jeremiah, and this is Christian Anarchy, better than every other podcast on the internet, with the same name. We begin with concluding remarks, break up the pieces and examine the parts. Your words always cut when they're cliche, but here's my knife because I came for the buffet. This is the way it goes when you are part of it, nervously saying words, little surprising bed, a mark beneath the chin. Welcome to episode 9. A few housekeeping details before we begin. That metaphor makes me feel like a maid. If at any point you feel compelled to contact me, you can do so at jeremiahjm@gmail.com. And if at any point you want more of me, you can visit www.christianarchy.net. That's www.christianarchy.net. And if at any point you want less of me, stop listening. If at any point you're angry at me, you can find my address, come to my home and yell at me. I'll even give you free coffee. I've received a few questions and requests for topics, which I have not yet spoken about. I have not been ignoring these, but I've wanted to get a decent start on the biblical and ethical foundation for anarchy first, because, as predicted, most of the questions and topic requests are related to pragmatic fears, not refutations of the ethical arguments I have put forth. Two of the topic requests are deeply interconnected. One person suggested I talk more about property ownership and rights. Another suggested I talk about how the environment will be protected in a free society. What law might look like in a free society is also a question wrapped up in the ideas of property and environmental protection. Anyway, just letting you know, I haven't forgotten about you, and we'll get to your requested topics in time. Unless I get really mentally bogged down in the next month, you can expect me to start on those topics by mid-September. For today, we're going to talk about Israel's request for a king. In the Old Testament, the people of Israel didn't always have a king. After Israel was freed from slavery in Egypt, they had prophets who led and guided them. These prophets were the go-between with the people of Israel and God himself. They would seek out what God's will was for Israel and then inform them of it. The prophets would know the history of Israel and the law and tell Israel, in the present context, what it looks like to follow the law and honor the God of their history. These prophets, of whom Moses was first and Joshua was the second, were often called judges. This is because one of the primary roles of these prophetic leaders was to resolve disputes between the people of Israel. They would hear testimonies, examine evidence, and judge whether or not someone had wronged someone else or had broken the law, and then would mete out punishment and consequences accordingly. There were many small judges in local cities in Israel who would determine the outcome of small disputes and law violations. But the prophetic leaders of Israel were the head judges who would rule over the most difficult cases. There was, however, no king. There was just someone to convey God's will to the people and to help maintain order through dispute resolution. A guy named Samuel was one such prophet who became judge. When he was a young boy, he went and lived with a priest named Eli. During this time, God spoke to Samuel about Eli's sons being rejected as priests due to their dishonesty and mistreatment of the people who were seeking their help in the tabernacle. Samuel's words came true, and so he was respected as a prophet who has a trustworthy relationship with God. A little later in the text, Samuel calls the people of Israel to repentance, to getting rid of the idols from other nations they were worshiping alongside of God, and turning toward him completely by worshiping and following him alone. In the same story, the Philistines were mounting an attack against Israel. At the behest of the people, Samuel prayed and continued praying for Israel while the Philistines drew near to violently take over the nation. While Samuel was praying, The Israelites fought against the encroaching Philistines and drove them back away from the Jewish people. Because of these things, Samuel was seen as a reliable person and a beneficial asset to the community, and so was made judge of Israel based upon his own merit. The text for today follows these stories and comes from 1 Samuel 8, near the end of Samuel's life. 1 Samuel 8:1-9 says, "When Samuel became old, he made his sons judges over Israel. The name of the firstborn son was Joel, and the name of his second, Abijah. They were judges in Beersheba. Yet his sons did not walk in his ways, but turned aside after gain. They took bribes and perverted justice. Then all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah and said to him, 'Behold, you are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint for us a king to judge us like all the nations.' But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, 'Give us a king to judge us.' And Samuel prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to Samuel, 'Obey the voice of the people in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from being king over them. According to all the deeds that they have done, from the day I brought them out of Egypt even to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are also doing to you. Now then, obey their voice. Only you shall solemnly warn them and show them the ways of the king who shall reign over them.'" The people started to become angry and frustrated with the current system in place because Samuel's sons began to take over. Samuel's sons have the same issue Eli's sons had. They aren't good people, and they use their position of power to abuse others. They are terrible choices for judges because they have done nothing to earn it. While in the case of Eli's sons, they were rejected and Samuel was chosen instead, in this case, there is no discernible alternative candidate. It's odd for Samuel to be in this position because he was chosen due to his merit. But having his sons perform his job after him, simply because they are his sons, is not a system of merit. The text doesn't say Samuel searched for the best people to institute as judges, or that he prayed to God to guide him in deciding who should be the ultimate arbiter of disputes for Israel. Instead, Samuel goes out on his own and chooses his sons to be judges. I think this is Samuel doing what the people of Israel are frequently accused of doing. He's following in the example of the nations surrounding him. These nations transfer positions of power and authority, like being a judge, to the children of the one who held the position, as if the position is property to be inherited. The people of Israel give multiple reasons for their desire to have a king reign over them. Their first, as we discussed, was that Samuel's sons were being horrible judges. This is an understandable and sensible motivation for wanting a system change. Something needs to be different so people can get actual justice. Seeking a change is reasonable. Seeking a king is pretty ignorant, however, as the history of kings doesn't usually include the lowest of society acquiring justice. They probably don't know of many other options, however, and this may be the only alternative to a system of judges they can imagine. The second reason people give for their desire for a king is that all of the other surrounding nations have kings. They want to be like them. This is a terrible reason, a superficial reasoning for their desire. In the previous chapter, they just got rid of the idols from the nations around them and were blessed with a victory over the invading Philistines. Their distinction led to their protection. Now they want to become like those nations in a slightly different way than assimilating their gods. Now they want to assimilate their practice of having kings. God has always talked about his people being holy, being set apart from other nations. There are many ways God wants his people to do this. They are to be distinct in how they treat foreigners, who they marry, how they dress, what sort of gods they worship, etc. And also, part of the way they should be set apart is in their system of social organization. Their lack of a king and formal government authority structure made them unique among the other nations. How did he want them to be distinct in this way? I think what God wants for his people is what we talked about way back in Genesis 1. God made the world with a hierarchical structure where God was above humanity, humanity was on the same level as each other and above the earth, the animals, and the plants. The social organization of Israel, prior to having a king, much more closely approximated this hierarchy, with far fewer coercive hierarchies between people. But Israel didn't want to be organized different than other nations. They wanted someone to make decisions for them and tell them what to do like the other nations had. God wanted them to be set apart. They wanted to be indistinguishable. Something about Israel's desire for a king irked Samuel. He didn't like it when they wanted a king to judge them instead of a prophet. Whether this is because Samuel was upset with the idea his sons wouldn't get to be judges, or because it reflected poorly on him, I'm not sure. But he responded correctly to his sense of displeasure. He prayed. God says something quite vulnerable in response to Samuel. God takes on the rejection of the desires of Israel for a king. While it is Samuel's offspring the people are upset with, and it is their misbehavior which is the impetus for the people's desire to acquire a king, God basically tells Samuel not to be worried about it, not to take it personally. God says they are really rejecting him. By doing this, God indicates it is not Samuel's flaws which have led them to this, but their own heart issues. They're rejecting their only true king in their pursuit of another king to reign over them. God also links this rejection of him as king to the idolatry of Israel. Their desire for the king is just the people doing what they have done repeatedly since God freed them from slavery in Egypt. They're constantly seeking to be like the other nations around them. Their worshiping of other idols was a forsaking of God as their true God. In the same way, their institution of a human king is a forsaking of God as their true king. Seeking someone to rule over them was for Israel an act of idolatry. Idolatry doesn't mean Israel worshipped the idols of the nations around them and not God. In most of the stories, we see the Israelites worshipped both Yahweh, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the local gods of the surrounding nations. In monotheism, idolatry isn't just worshipping other gods as superior to the one God. It is worshipping anything in addition to the one true God. It doesn't matter if the people of Israel are still putting God first on their list of gods. What matters is that they have any other god on their list other than the one who brought them out of Egypt. It is unlikely when the people of Israel asked for a king, they were thinking their king would be superior to Yahweh, their God. They weren't trying to get rid of God in their request for a king or subjugate him to their new king. They were just trying to add a king in between them and God. They rejected God as their king by trying to add a king to the relationship. God doesn't want to be one of the kings of Israel or the top king of Israel, but the only king of Israel. Anything else is a rejection of him and a displacement of him from his rightful place over his people. God is at least kind enough to give the Israelites a fair warning about some of the negative things which will be the natural result of their desire for a king, perhaps with the hopes they will change their mind, or perhaps so they can't blame him for not giving them a fair warning, or maybe both. He warns them through Samuel in 1 Samuel 8, verses 10 through 18. The text says, "So Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking for a king from him. He said, 'These will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run before his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties, and some to plow his ground and reap his harvest, and to make his implements of war and the equipment of his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards and give them to his servants. He will take the tenth of your grain and of your vineyards and give it to his officers and his servants. He will take your male servants and your female servants and the best of your young men and your donkeys and put them to his work. He will take the tenth of your flocks, and you shall be his slaves. And in that day you will cry out because of your king, whom you have chosen for yourselves, but the Lord will not answer you in that day. There is nothing unexpected in these warnings, nor is there anything uniquely horrible about what these warnings are. These are descriptions of the way all nations at the time functioned. These are the natural things which happen under the reign of a king. What's most surprising about this list is that Israel hasn't yet experienced a life under such rule. The first thing the king does is gather together an army. Once he has power, step one to retaining power is to get together a bunch of people to protect it. Once he has the army organized, then Samuel warns the king will start figuring out how to use his new position over others to benefit himself, acquiring the perfumers, cooks, and bakers to make his home a more enjoyable and better-tasting place to reside. Then he'll start working to expand his power and grow his wealth and position. Like any ruler, the king will have authority and power over all the people and land in the nation, and so the right to violate the property rights of others to do what he will. So the king will take the best of the land from people and have his servants work it. In addition, of the land he doesn't take, he'll expect people to pay him taxes, to give him a percentage of what their land produces. When he runs out of servants to work the land he has taken and maintain the wealth he keeps acquiring, no problem. He'll just take more servants from his subjects. God, through Samuel, describes this violation of property rights and the taking of land, labor, and the product of one's labor as slavery. I would tend to agree with them. Again, these aren't far-fetched warnings the people of Israel would have heard and thought, oh, no way that could happen. Samuel is just trying to trick us. Anyone who knew about how other nations were run and who spent even a moment in consideration would have recognized these warnings were simply describing the natural course of events which would occur once power is centralized in the hands of a king and whoever he places in power under him. Anytime you centralize power in the hands of a few over the many, you should expect that power to continue to grow and increase in oppression. After all these warnings, God also warns he will not interfere if they see the result of having chosen a king and look back with regret. He is not going to protect his people from the consequences of their choices. He wants them to face the outcomes of their decisions that they might grow as people, perhaps make better decisions in the future, and have the wisdom of experience to pass on to their kids. God with Israel is the same God we saw with Adam and Eve. He warns both groups, their choice to reject him, whether the rejection is the institution of a king or the eating of fruit, will have severe negative effects on them and the world around them. But as always, God wants people to have choice, and he wants such choice to have real power, power to do both good and evil. After doing a good job of giving the people a fair warning about what their decision will lead to, the people respond to God and Samuel in 1 Samuel 8, verses 19 through 21. But the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel, and they said, "No, but there shall be a king over us, that we may also be like all the nations, and that our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles." And when Samuel had heard all the words of the people, he repeated them in the ears of the Lord. And the Lord said to Samuel, "Obey their voice and make them a king." Samuel then said to the men of Israel, "Go, every man to his city." The prediction of the future does nothing to dissuade the people. They are determined to have a king reign over them, and insist Samuel choose a king for them, so they can be like the other nations, so they can have some superior judge between their disputes, and so they don't have to worry about defending their own land, but have a king to do it for them. The idea of the king has them under the illusion that once a king gains power, he's going to fight battles for his people and single-handedly win them, rather than what normally occurs, which is not the king fighting the battles of the people at all, but the king sending out the people to fight his battles. God's response is kind of weird for a lot of people who haven't read much scripture. It's often outside of their perspective of who he is and what he is like. To review, God doesn't want Israel to choose a king. God says their choosing of a king is a rejection of him. Then God begins the process of using Samuel to help Israel find a king. God goes along with what he never wanted Israel to do. God actually participates in the process of his own rejection. God remains with, interacts with, and helps his people even when they are in the middle of committing idolatry. Why would God do this? One, the people of Israel are pretty set on getting a king anyway. They're demanding their judge do what they ask of him, and even when they are warned about what will occur should they get a king, they insist upon having a king anyway. It would seem that in this situation, they are going to get a king for themselves, whether God likes it or not. So God's choices are to abandon his people, destroy his people, force them not to have a king, or let them have a king and go along with it and do what he can to make the best of it. I think God is seeking to bring the best out of a bad situation. By allowing them to do what he never wanted them to do, God is still present to play a role in the kings Israel sets up. They may be rejecting God, but at least he gets to pick the king. God can work to pick the kings who will hopefully lead best, who will hopefully perform their kingly duties the way God himself would. By remaining a part of Israel's new government, God can shape it and the people within it to do what he can to make it the best it could be, even though it is obviously less than the ideal. And finally, God wants to be in relationship with Israel. God is not in the business of abandoning his people. Even in the midst of being rejected by them, God makes a way for his people to continue in relationship with him. There are many stories in Scripture where we see God accommodating the sinful desires of humanity in order to remain in relationship with them, even while they are acting in a way which is contrary to his desires for them. For many, this seems like an odd way for God, especially one who created the whole universe, to act. Yet this is how we see him acting. This accommodation of humanity's sin and pursuing of relationship with them, despite it, is seen most clearly with Jesus, the most clear revelation of God we have on the cross. God never wanted Israel to have a king, but he went along with it. He even uses Samuel to choose the king to reign over them. God put in place a king to rule over Israel. He ordained Israel's king. By his authority, he deliberately set up a human monarchy to rule over the people of Israel. And God never wanted any of these things. For those of you familiar with Romans 13, this will be an important idea to keep in mind when we get to it. God can and does ordain things, very specifically rulers, he doesn't actually want to be in place, because he chooses to work within the institutions humans set up to bring the most good out of even evil institutions like government. So what ended up happening with the kings later? Pretty much everything Samuel warned against and more. Thousands of lives were lost to war. Thousands of women were taken to be the cooks and servants and wives and concubines of the many kings of Israel. Taxation funded all of what the kings chose to do to benefit themselves, grow and protect their kingdom, and maintain and expand their tax base. Often the kings were living in riches, while the tabernacle and temple of God, the place of God's residence among his people, went uncared for and was under-resourced. For the tithe which the people were supposed to give for the religious practices of the nation, instead went to the king in the form of taxation. Over and over, the kings of Israel led the people into the idolatry of the nations around them. So not only did they have a king like other nations, but they got to be just like them by worshiping their gods as well. The nation of Israel was frequently at war as well. The nation endured coups and violent transitions of power. At one point, they became divided into two different nations with two different kings, the nation of Israel and the nation of Judah. The two nations remained divided and even fought against each other. Eventually, the poor leadership of the kings of Israel led to the people of both nations of Israel being defeated by foreign conquerors and exiled to foreign lands. This is the legacy the institution of kings left Israel. In light of this stuff, when we read stories about God having a close relationship with people like David or Solomon or other kings, let's not jump to the conclusion that God was really stoked about them being king in the first place. When we read about the many times God uses governments and about how God still uses governments to accomplish his good purposes for humanity, there's no need to assume God loves government and thinks it's a good and crucial organization for people. God does with governments what he often finds himself doing, working with and through sinful people to make the best of what is, using people to move the world toward redemption. But maybe this destruction Israel's government brought to them was because of the way the bad kings behaved. It was the worst of kings who destroyed the fortunes of the people of God. Perhaps the issue is the right human kings weren't in power. If the people could just get the right kings into that position, then maybe their government would work really well. Maybe everything would go better. We can't just take the bad king's example and decide instituting rulers over Israel was bad, can we? No. Thankfully, we don't have to. Next week, we will talk about the best king Israel ever had, who also does worse things than anyone I have ever met. As always, I am grateful for you taking your time to listen to me today, wherever you're at. I hope you have a wonderful day, week, month, year, life. I'll talk to you next week. Bye-bye. Wisdom, light my way into the dark.